బడ్జెట్ ప్రవేశపెడుతున్నారు లైవ్ లో చూద్దాం
ద పీపుల్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా హావ్ డిసైసివ్లీ ఓటెడ్ ఫర్ ఎ చేంజ్ ద వర్డిక్ట్ రిప్రజెంట్స్ ది ఎగ్జాస్పరేషన్ ఆఫ్ ద పీపుల్ విత్ ద స్టేటస్ కో ఇండియా అన్హెసిటేటింగ్లీ డిజైర్స్ టు గ్రో దోస్ లివింగ్ బిలో ద పవర్టీ లైన్ ఆర్ యాంగ్షియస్ టు ఫ్రీ దెమ్సెల్వ్స్ ఫ్రమ్ ద కర్స్ ఆఫ్ పవర్టీ Those who have got an opportunity to emerge from the difficult challenges have become aspirational. They now want to be a part of the new middle class. Their next generation has a hunger to use the opportunity that society provides for them. Slow decision making has resulted in a loss of opportunity. 2 years of sub 5% growth in the Indian economy has resulted in a challenging situation. We look forward to lower levels of inflation as compared to the days of double digit rates of food inflation in the last 2 years. The country is in no mood to suffer unemployment, inadequate basic amenities, lack of infrastructure and apathetic governance. The slowdown in India broadly reflects the trend in many economies. In contrast to the aftermath of the crisis of 2008-2009, when restoration of growth in advanced economies was a primary concern, the continuing slowdown being presently witnessed in many emerging economies has posed a threat to sustained global recovery. Fortunately, there are green shoots of recovery being seen in the global economy. As per the IMF, the world economy is projected to grow at 3.6% in 2014, vis-a-vis 3% in 2013. With the euro area expected to register a positive growth after a contraction witnessed in 2012 and 13. However, the performance of the US economy with the attendant implications for an unconventional monetary policy stance and global financial conditions is pivotal to the fate of the global recovery in the coming years. These are the headwinds against which the Indian economy would have to maneuver its way to attain a higher growth trajectory. As Finance Minister, I am bound to usher in a policy regime that will result in a desired macroeconomic outcome of higher growth, lower inflation, sustained level of external balance, and prudent policy stance. The budget is the most comprehensive action plan in this regard. In the first budget of the NDA government that I am presenting before the August House, my aim is to lay down a broad policy indicator of the direction in which we wish to take the economy. The steps I will announce in this budget are only the beginning of a journey towards a sustained growth of 7 to 8% or above within the next 3-4 years, with the macroeconomic stabilization, which includes lower levels of inflation, less fiscal deficit, and manageable current account deficit. Therefore, it would not be wise to expect anything that can be done or must be done in the first budget presented within 45 days of the formation of the government. While higher growth is a sine qua non, we cannot be oblivious of the fact that there is a large population of this country which is below the poverty line. It is the poor who suffer the most. We have to ensure that our anti-poverty programs are well targeted. The growing aspiration of the people will be reflected in the development strategy followed by the government, led by the Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi, and the mandate of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. Allow me to assure this Honourable House that we have taken up this challenge in the right earnest. We shall leave no stone unturned in creating a vibrant and strong India. The prevailing economic situation presents a great challenge. It calls for a conscious choice to be made by all of us. Should we allow this drift to carry on and watch helplessly? Should we allow our future to suffer because of our indecisiveness? Should we be victims of mere populism or wasteful expenditure? To me, the response and the remedy are both clear. The task before me today is very challenging because we need to revive growth, particularly in the manufacturing sector and infrastructure, to raise adequate resources for our developmental needs. On the one hand, the task is simple if we accept the principle that we cannot spend beyond our means. We need to introduce fiscal prudence that will lead to fiscal consolidation and discipline. Fiscal prudence to me is of paramount importance because of considerations of intergenerational equity. We cannot leave behind a legacy of debt for our future generations. We cannot go on spending today, which would be financed by taxation on a future date. There is an urgent need to generate more resources to fuel the economy. For this, the tax GDP ratio must be improved and the non-tax revenues increased. We must remember that the decline of fiscal deficit from 5.7% of the GDP in 2011-12 to 4.8% in 2012-13 and 4.5% in 2013-14 was mainly achieved by a reduction in expenditure rather than by way of realization of higher revenues. Although the external sector witnessed a turnaround with the year ending with a current account deficit of 1.7% of the GDP against 4.7% in 2012-13, this was mainly achieved through restriction of non-essential imports and slowdown in the overall aggregate demand. Going forward, we must continue to be watchful of the CAD. My predecessor had set up a very difficult task of reducing the fiscal deficit to 4.1% of the GDP in the current year. Considering that we have 2 years of low GDP growth, an almost static industrial growth, a moderate increase in indirect taxes, a large subsidy burden, and not so encouraging tax buoyancy, the target of 4.1% fiscal deficit is indeed daunting. Difficult as it may appear, I have decided to accept this target as a challenge. One fails only when one stops trying. My roadmap for fiscal consolidation is a fiscal deficit of 3.6% for 2015-16 and 3% for 2016-17. I am conscious of the fact that the Iraq crisis is leaving behind an impact on oil prices and the situation in the Middle East continues to be volatile. Monsoon this year appears to be more unpredictable, while inflation has remained at elevated levels relative to what it is perceived as acceptable. There is a gradual moderation in the WPI recently, from a high of 7.35% in 2012-13 to 5.98% in 2013-14. But we are still not out of the woods. We must address fully the problem of black money, which is a curse on our economy. Faced with these adversities, we have no option but to undertake some bold steps in order to enhance economic activity, to spur growth in the economy. These steps are only the beginning of our effort to revive the growth spirit of the Indian economy. They are directional. Expenditure Management Commission. My government is committed to the principle of minimum government, maximum governance. To achieve this goal, time has come to revive the allocative and operational efficiencies of government expenditure to achieve the maximum output. The government will constitute an expenditure management commission which will look into various aspects of expenditure reform to be undertaken by the government. The commission will give its interim report within this financial year. I also propose to overhaul the subsidy regime, including food and petroleum subsidies, and make it more targeted and provide full protection to the marginalized, poor, scheduled caste, scheduled tribes. A new urea policy would be formulated. The debate on whether to introduce the goods and services tax must now come to an end. We have discussed the issue for the past many years. Some states have been apprehensive about surrendering their taxation jurisdiction. Others want to be adequately compensated. I have discussed the matter with the states both individually and collectively. I do hope we are able to bring a final solution in this course of this year and approve the legislative scheme which enables the introduction of the GST. This will streamline tax administration, avoid harassment of business, and result in higher tax collection both for the centre and the states. I assure all states that government will be more than fair in dealing with them. Tax administration. The sovereign right of the government to undertake retrospective legislation is unquestionable. However, this power has to be exercised with extreme caution and judiciousness, keeping in mind the impact of each such measure on the economy and the overall investment climate. This government will not ordinarily bring any change retrospectively which creates a fresh liability. Honorable members are aware that consequent upon the retrospective amendment of Income Tax Act 1961, undertaken by the Finance Bill of 2012, a few cases have come up in various courts and other legal fora. These cases are at different stage of pendency and will naturally reach their logical conclusion. At this junction, I would like to convey to this august house and also to the investor community at large that we are committed to providing a stable and predictable taxation regime which would be investor friendly and spur growth. Keeping this in mind, we have decided that henceforth all cases arising out of the retrospective amendments of 2012 in respect of indirect transfers and coming to the notice of assessing officers will be scrutinized by a high-level committee to be constituted by the CBDT before any action is initiated in such cases. I hope the investor community, both within India and abroad, will repose confidence on our stated position and participate in India's growth story with renewed vigour. Tax demand of more than 4 lakh crores is under dispute and litigation before various courts and appellate authorities. This is one of the serious concerns of all taxpayers in the country. In order to reduce litigation in direct taxes, I propose to make certain legislative and administrative changes. Currently, an advance ruling can be obtained about tax liability of a non-resident from authority for advance rulings. The facility is not available to resident taxpayers except public sector undertakings. I propose to enable the resident taxpayers to obtain an advance ruling in respect of their income tax liability with a defined threshold. I also propose to strengthen the authority for advance rulings by constituting additional benches. I further propose to enlarge the scope of Income Tax Settlement Commission so that taxpayers may approach the Commission for settlement of disputes. This would continue to be once in a lifetime opportunity for any taxpayer. As an administrative measure, I propose to set up a high-level committee to interact with trade and industry on a regular basis and ascertain areas where clarity in tax laws is required. Based on recommendations of this committee, the Central Board of Direct Taxes and the Central Board of Excise and Customs shall issue appropriate clarifications wherever considered necessary on tax issues within a period of 2 months. Transfer pricing is a major area of litigation for both residents and non-residents. I have proposed certain changes in the transfer pricing regulations, which I would spell out in Part B of my speech. I hope these measures would go a long way in improving the confidence of taxpayers in the tax system and provide certainty and clarity in tax laws. Foreign direct investment. The policy of the NDA government is to promote foreign direct investments selectively in sectors where it helps the larger interest of the Indian economy. FDI in several sectors is an additionality of resource which helps in promoting domestic manufacturing and job creation. India today needs a boost for job creation on manufacturing sector in particular needs a push for job creation. India today is the largest buyer of defense equipment in the world. Our domestic manufacturing capabilities are still at a nascent stage. We are buying substantial part of our defense requirements directly from foreign players, companies controlled by foreign governments, and foreign private parties are supplying our defense requirement to us at a considerable outflow of foreign exchange. Currently, we permit 26% FDI in defense manufacturing. The composite cap of foreign exchange is being raised to 49% with full management control, Indian management and control through the FIPB route. The insurance sector is investment starved. Several segments of the insurance sector need an expansion. The composite cap of the insurance sector is proposed to be increased up to 49% from the current level of 26% with full management and control through the FIPB route. To encourage development of smart cities, which will also provide habitation for this new middle class, requirement of the built-up area of capital conditions for FDI is being reduced from 50,000 square meters to 20,000 square meters and from $10 million to $5 million, respectively, with a 3-year post-completion lock-in. To further encourage these projects, which commit at least 30% of the total project costs for low-cost, affordable housing will be exempted for the minimum built-up area and capitalization requirements with conditions of 3-year lock-in. FDI in the manufacturing sector today is on an automatic route. The manufacturing units will be allowed to sell its products through retail, including e-commerce platforms, without any additional approval. Back capitalization. Financial stability is the foundation of our rapid recovery. Our banking system needs to be further strengthened. To be in line with the Basel III norms, there is a requirement to infuse 2,40,000 crores rupees as equity by 2018 in our banks. To meet this huge capital requirement, we need to raise additional resources to fill this obligation. While preserving the public ownership, the capital of these banks will be raised by increasing the shareholding of the capital in a phased manner through sale of shares, largely through retail common citizens in the country. Thus, while government will continue to hold majority shareholding, the citizens of India will also get direct shareholding in these banks, which currently they hold indirectly. We will also examine the proposal to give greater autonomy to banks while making them accountable. PSU capital expenditure. To give a thrust to investment in the economy, PSUs will also play their part constructively. I am assured that PSUs will invest through capital investment a total amount of rupees 2,47,941 crores in the current financial years to create a virtuous investment cycle. Smart cities. As the fruits of development reach an increasingly large number of people, the pace of migration from rural areas to the cities is increasing. A new middle class is emerging, which has aspirations of better living standards. Unless new cities are developed to accommodate the burgeoning number of people, through existing cities would become unlivable. The Prime Minister has a vision of developing 100 smart cities as satellite towns of larger cities by modernizing the existing mid-sized cities. To provide the necessary focus to this critical activity, I have provided a sum of rupees 7,060 crores in the current fiscal. E-visas. Tourism is one of the larger job creators globally. Many economies world over are supported by tourism. In order to give a major boost to tourism, the facility of electronic travel authorization, e-visas would be introduced in a phased manner at 9 airports in India, where necessary infrastructure would be put in place within the next 6 months. The countries in which electronic travel authorization facility to which it will be extended would be identified in a phased manner. This would further the facility of visa on arrival. REITs and InvestITs. Real estate investment trusts have been successfully used as instruments for pooling investment in several countries. I intend to introduce to provide necessary incentives for REITs, which will have a pass-through for the purposes of taxation. As an innovation, a modified REITs type structure for infrastructure projects is also being announced as Infrastructure Investment Trust, which would have a similar pass-through status for PPP and other infrastructure projects. These structures would reduce the pressure on the banking system while making available fresh equity. I am confident these instruments would attract long-term finance from foreign and domestic sources, including the NRIs. Kisan Vikas Patras was a very popular instrument among small paving. I plan to introduce the instrument to encourage people who have banked and unbanked savings to invest in these instruments. Skill India. A national multi-skill program called Skill India is proposed to be launched. It would skill the youth for an emphasis of employability and entrepreneurial skills. It will also provide training and support for traditional professions like welders, carpenters, cobblers, masons, blacksmiths, weavers. Convergence of various schemes to attain this objective is also proposed. The Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sichai Yojana. Bulk of our farmlands are rain-fed and dependent on monsoons. Therefore, there is a need to provide assured irrigation to mitigate risk. To improve access to irrigation, we propose to initiate a scheme, Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sichai Yojana. I propose to set aside 1,000 crores for this purpose. Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. The need for sanitation is of utmost importance. Although the central government is providing resources within its means, the task of total sanitation cannot be achieved without the support of all. The government intends to cover every household by total sanitation by the year 2019, the 150th year of the birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi, through the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. Gujarat has demonstrated successfully the rural development model of urbanization of rural areas, through which people living in rural areas can effectively get civic infrastructure associated services. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Rural Mission will be launched to deliver the integrated project-based infrastructure in rural areas, which will also include the development of economic activities till development. The preferred mode of delivery would be the PPPs, while using various schemes funds for financing. Power is a vital input for economic growth, and the government is committed to providing 24/7 uninterrupted power supply to all homes. The Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana for feeder separation will be launched to augment power supply to the rural areas and strengthening the sub-transmission and distribution systems. I propose to set aside 500 crores for this purpose. The government of Gujarat has embarked upon a mission to build the largest statue of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. Sardar Patel stands as a symbol of unity of this country. To support the Gujarat government in this initiative to erect the Statue of Unity, I propose to set aside rupees 200 crores. Madam, I now turn to the budgetary allocations. While announcing the allocations, I want to reiterate my government's firm commitment to strengthen the federal structure of the country, our resolve to work closely with the state governments for the larger good of the people. Government is committed to the welfare of the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. This year, an amount of ₹50,548 crores is proposed under the scheduled caste plan and ₹32,387 crores under the TSP. To provide credit enhancement facility for young startup entrepreneurs from scheduled caste who aspire to be a part of the new middle class, I propose to separately set aside ₹200 crores, which will be operationalized through a scheme of the IFCI. For the welfare of tribals, the One Bandhu Kalyan Yojana is being launched with an initial allocation of ₹100 crores. Welfare of senior, please wait. Welfare of senior citizens. The NDA government, during the last term in office, had introduced the Varishth Pension Bima Yojana as a pension scheme for senior citizens. Under the scheme, a total number of 3.1 lakh annuitants were being benefited from the corpus amount of ₹6,095 crores. I propose to revive the scheme for a limited period from 15th August 2014 to 14th August 2015 for the benefit of all citizens aged 60 years or above. A large number of amount of money is estimated to be lying in the unclaimed accounts of the PPF, post office, savings schemes, etc. Those are mostly out of investments belonging to the senior citizens, and on their demise remain unclaimed for want of relevant payment instructions. I propose to set up a committee to examine and recommend how this amount can be used to protect the further financial interests of the senior citizens. The committee will give its report not later than December this year. Government is fully committed to the social security and the welfare employees serving in the organized sector, the government is notifying minimum pension of rupees 1000 per month to all subscriber members of the EP scheme and has made an initial contribution of rupees 250 crores in the current financial years to meet the expenditure. Further increase in the mandatory wage ceiling of subscription of the EPS from 6,500 to 15,000 has been made. A provision of rupees 250 crores has been provided in the current budget. For the convenience of subscribers, EPFO will launch a unified account scheme service for contributing members and facility portability of the Provident Fund accounts. Empowerment of the differently abled persons. Government will make an all-out effort to create a more inclusive society for persons with disabilities to enable them to enjoy equal opportunities and to lead an empowered life with dignity. I propose to extend the assistance to the disabled persons for purchase fittings, aids and appliances to include contemporary aids and assistive devices. It will also propose to establish a national level institute for universal inclusive design and mental health rehabilitation and also a center for disability sports. Incentives for visually challenged. The Braille press says in the government and the private sectors are not able to meet the demand of the textbooks for the visually impaired students. It is proposed to provide assistance of the state governments to establish 15 new press and modernize the 10 existing presses in the current financial year. The government will also print currency notes with Braille-like signs to assist the visibly challenged persons. Women's safety is a concern shared by all honourable members of the House. We need to test our different approaches that can be validated and scaled up quickly. An outlay of rupees 50 crores will be spent by the Ministry of Road Transport on a pilot scheme on the safety of women in public road transport. A sum of rupees 150 crore will be spent by the Ministry of Home on a scheme to increase the safety of women in larger cities. It is also proposed to provide a crisis management center in all districts of the NCT Delhi this year in all government and private hospitals. The funding will be provided from the Nirbhaya Fund. Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao Yojana. It is a shame that while the country has emerged as a major player amongst the emerging economies, the apathy towards the girl child is still quite rampant in these many parts of the country. Therefore, I propose to launch the Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao Yojana, which will be focused scheme which will help in generating awareness and also improve the efficiency of the delivery welfare services meant for women. I propose to set aside a sum of rupees 100 crores for this. Gender mainstreaming. The government would focus on campaigns to sensitize people in this country towards the concerns of the girl child and women. The process of sensitization must begin early. Therefore, school curriculum will have a separate chapter on gender mainstreaming. The Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, initiated during NDA 1 under the stewardship of Prime Minister Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, has had a massive impact in improvement of access to rural population. It is time to reaffirm our commitment to a better and more energetic PMGSY under the dynamic leadership of Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi. I propose to provide a sum of rupees 14,389 crores for this purpose. Manrega. The government is committed to provide wage and self-employment opportunities in rural areas. However, wage employment would be provided under the Manrega through works that are more productive, asset creating, substantially linked to agriculture and allied activities. Ajivika, the national rural, aims at eliminating rural poverty through sustainable livelihood options. Under this mission, women SCGs are provided bank loans at 4% to prompt repayment in 150 districts and 7% in other districts. I propose to extend the provisions of blank loan for women SDGs at 4% in another 100 districts. I propose to set up a startup village entrepreneurship scheme for encouraging rural youth to take up local entrepreneurship programs. I am providing a sum of rupees 100 crores for this. the amount is there, don't worry, it's maintained.
I mentioned that, that's why I'm asking.
Never happened.
The rural housing scheme has benefited a large percentage of rural population who have availed credit through rural housing programs. I propose to increase the allocation for 2014-15 to 8,000 crores for National Housing Banking Program with a view to expand and continue to support rural housing in the country. To give an added impetus to the watershed program in the country, I propose to start a new program called the Nilanchal with an initial outlay of rupees 2,142 crores in the current financial year. Backward Region Grant Fund is being implemented in 272 backward districts in 27 states to fill the critical gap in the development of basic infrastructure facilities for capacity building of panchayats, gram sabhas in the backward areas. It is proposed to restructure the BRGF to address inter-district inequalities to ensure the backward sub-district units within the state get adequate support. Many of our drinking water resources have excess impurities like fluoride, arsenic, and man-made contaminations due to untreated sewerage, industrial effluents, and leaching of pesticides and fertilizers. It is proposed to earmark rupees 3,600 crores under National Rural Drinking Water Program for providing a safe drinking water approximately 20,000 habitations affected with arsenic, fluoride, heavy toxic elements, pesticides, fertilizers through community water purification plants in the next 3 years. To move towards health for all, two key initiatives, that is the free drug service and free diagnostic service, would be taken up on a priority. In order to achieve a universal access to each quality diagnosis and treatment to TB patients, two national institutes of aging will be set up at the AIIMS, New Delhi and Madras Medical College, Chennai, a national level research with referral institute for higher dental studies would also be set up in one of the existing dental institutions. It is a matter of great satisfaction that all the six new AIIMS at Jodhpur, Bhopal, Patna, Rishikesh, Bhubaneswar, and Raipur, which were a part of the Pradhan Mantri Swasthya Suraksha Yojana, have become functional. A plan to set up four more AIIMS institutions in Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, Vidarbh in Maharashtra and Purvanchal is under consideration. I propose to set up rupees 500 crore for this presently. Please wait for the next sentence. Aage aa raha hai.
Please, pura suniye.
Presently, please wait for the next sentence. Government medical colleges have been approved. It is proposed to add 12 more government medical colleges. In addition, dental facilities will also be provided in these hospitals. All other states which are making a request will be considered under this. For the first time, and let me add that in the coming years of the government, each year in the states where there is no AIIMS, we'll be adding it to make sure that there is an AIIMS created in every state in the country. For the first time, the central government will provide central assistance to strengthen the state drug regulatory and food regulatory systems by creating new drug testing laboratories and strengthening 31 existing laboratories. In keeping with the government's focus on improving affordable healthcare and to augment transfer of technology for better healthcare facilities in rural India, 15 model rural health research centers will be set up, which will take up the research on local health issues concerning rural population. Elementary education is one of the major priorities of the government. There would be a residual gap in providing minimal school infrastructure facilities. government would strive to provide toilets and drinking waters in all the girls' schools in the first place. An amount of rupees 28,635 crore is being funded by the Sarva Siksha Abhiyan and 4,966 crores by the Rashtriya Madhyamik Siksha Abhiyan. A school assessment program is being initiated at a cost of rupees 30 crores. To infuse the training tools and innovative teachers, the Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya new teachers training program is being launched. I am setting aside a sum of rupees 500 crores for this. To take advantage of the reach of the IT, I propose to allocate a sum of rupees 100 crores for setting up a virtuous classroom as communication linked interface for cultivating knowledge on the online courses. The country needs a large number of courses of higher learning, of which are of the world class. I propose to set up the Loknayak Jayaprakash Narayan National Center for Excellence in Humanities in Madhya Pradesh. I also intend to set up 5 more IITs in Jammu, Chhattisgarh, Goa, Andhra Pradesh, and Kerala. 5 more IIMs would be set up in the state of Himachal Pradesh, Punjab, Bihar, Orissa, and Maharashtra. I propose to set up an amount of rupees 500 crores for this. Government also proposes to ease and simplify norms and facilitate education of loans for higher education. There have been imminent need to further bridge and divide the human digital divide of between the haves and the have-nots. For this, it is proposed to launch a pan-India program, Digital India. This would ensure broadband connectivity at village level, improved access to services through IT-enabled programs, greater transparency in government processes, and increased indigenous production of the IT hardware and software of exports and improved domestic availability. Special focus will be on supporting software product startups. A national rural internet and technology mission service in villages and trainings in IT and e-Kranti for the government services delivery and governance scheme is also proposed. I have provided a sum of rupees 500 crores for this purpose. A program for promoting good governance would be launched. I propose to set up a sum of rupees 100 crores for this purpose. So far, around 400 permissions for setting up community radio stations have been issued. To encourage the growth of this sector, a new plan is being taken up with an allocation of rupees 100 crores. The scheme would support 600 new and existing community radio stations. The Film and Television Institute Pune, the Satyajit Ray Film and Television Institute Calcutta are proposed to be accorded the status of institutes of national importance and national centers of excellence in animation, gaming, special efforts will be set up. Urban renewal. It is time that our cities and towns undergo urban renewal and become better places to live in. While developing housing and other infrastructure, both physical and economic, which can have various local variations, four fundamental activities must underpin such development. These are: there are provision for drinking, safe drinking water and sewerage management, use of recycled water for growing organic fruits and vegetables, solid waste management, and digital connectivity. It will be the vision of the government that at least 500 such habitants must be provided support while harnessing private capital and expertise through PPPs to renew their infrastructure services in the next 10 years. Pooled municipal debt obligations. This facility was set up in 2006 with participation of several banks to promote finance infrastructure projects in urban areas on the shared risk basis. Present corpus of this facility is rupees 5,000 crore. The government has a major focus of providing good infrastructure, including public transport, waste disposal, sewage treatment, and safe drinking water in urban areas. In keeping with the Honorable Prime Minister's vision of urban areas, it is proposed to enlarge 50,000 crores with extension of facility by 5 years to March 31, 2019. Urban metro projects have proved to be very useful in decongesting large cities. For 2 million plus cities, planning of the metro phase must begin now. Government will encourage development of metro rail system, including the light rail system in the PPP mode, which will be supported by the central government through the VGF. In the current financial year, I propose to set aside a scheme of rupees 100 crores for the metro projects of Lucknow and Ahmedabad. The government is committed to an endeavour to have housing for all by 2022. For this purpose, I intend to extend the additional tax incentive on housing loans to encourage people, especially the young, to own their houses. I proposed of setting up a mission of low-cost affordable housing, which will be anchored by the National Housing Bank schemes, which will be involved to incentivize the development of low-cost affordable housing. I propose to allocate this a sum of rupees 4,000 crores for the National Housing Bank in view to increase the flow of cheaper credit and affordable housing for the urban poor, economically weaker section, LIG segment. I have already outlined some other incentives such as easier flow of FDI in this sector. Government is willing to examine other suggestions which would spurt growth in this sector. I also propose to add an inclusion of a slum development in the list of corporate social responsibility activities to encourage private sector to contribute more towards this activity. A national program in the mission mode is urgently required to halt the deteriorating malnutrition situation in the country. At present, interventions are not adequate. A comprehensive strategy, including detailed methodology, costing timelines, and monitoring targets, will be in place within 6 months. Minorities. A program for the upgradation of skills and training in the ancestral arts for development of minorities, called the Upgrading of Traditional Arts and Resource Goods, would be launched to preserve the traditional arts crafts with a rich heritage. An additional amount of rupees 100 crores for modernization of madrasas has been provided in the Department of School Education. Farming is an activity which contributes to nearly 1/6 of our national GDP and a major portion of a population is dependent on its livelihood. It has risen to the challenge of making India largely self-sufficient in providing food for a growing population. To make farming competitive and profitable, there is an urgent need to set up investment, both public and private, in agro technology and development and creation of modernization and easing of agricultural business infrastructure. And Agricultural Research Institute Pune has been in the forefront of research in this area. However, since independence, only one of the such centers has been established. Government will establish two more such institutions of excellence of similar pattern in Assam and Jharkhand with an initial sum of rupees 100 crores in the current financial years. In addition, an amount of rupees 100 crores is being set aside for setting up an agri-infrastructure fund. It is also proposed to establish agricultural university in Andhra Pradesh and Rajasthan and horticulture university in Telangana and Haryana. An initial amount of 200 crore has been allocated for this purpose.
मैडम स्पीकर, कैन वी हैव अ 5 मिनट ब्रेक, 5 मिनट के लिए, 5 मिनट, देन आई विल कंटिन्यू टू रीड.
जस्ट टेक ए ब्रेक.
Just 5 minutes, please. Yes. Yeah, 5 minutes. This is the how.
the House stands adjourned to meet again at 11:50 for 5 minutes only. 11:50, 5 minutes. We want some break, no? It's okay. No, it's okay. 5 minutes break we have. 5 minutes break.